Good evening, folks, and it is really a pleasure to have you here. A pleasure to welcome you, Stephen Bulla, and the New England Brass Band. And, well, for all of those of us who have loved watching Downton Abbey through two seasons now, I think that one thing we can all agree on if we love music is that we're not getting a lot of music from that time in this series. The soundtrack is a terrific soundtrack, and we even had a chance to meet the composer of that soundtrack, but it is very definitely not of the time of Downton Abbey. Thank you for now providing us with that sound.
Some of that sound right into it from the British Isles, I guess.
That's right. That's right. Yeah, well, and maybe a lot of us actually figured that was written for a movie with Sir Alec Guinness, wasn't it? But no, in fact, it was from 1914.
It was originally written in 1914 by a British Army bandmaster who later went on to become the director of the Royal Marines. So there's an interesting story there. He goes on to, there's a little bit of information about that march that you just heard from Morgan. The tune that's in it comes from another military man, I guess a friend of the composer, who was also an avid golfer. And instead of yelling four on the golf course, he would whistle those two notes that you hear bottom at the beginning of every couple bars of the tune. And so I think that's how the composer took that and turned it into a march. But certainly the movie did cement the longevity of the march. It was in the Bridge Over the River Kwai.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Well, and so Stephen, this is a traditional British brass band. And I don't know if everyone here expected that this is what you were going to find here tonight, but indeed, this is not a wind band that we would normally find in our tradition of listening to a British brass band. There's something very specific, and why don't you just tell us a couple of things that make a brass band British?
Well, that's true, Brian. This is a very different from what you expect in a 20th century American band. Certainly, even in these days, brass bands in Great Britain started in the early 1800s. The miners in the colony towns were all looking for something to do, for lack of a better word, and they got together instead of watching TV, which they didn't have, or playing CDs or any of the electronics that we take for granted, and that are sort of pastimes for us. They had music, and that's what they did. So that's kind of where it started. But then brass players getting better and better along the years and decades, it became a competitive sport almost in Great Britain. And they still have to this day contests. That's part of the thing that keeps driving the British brass band movement. The other part of it is that great composers started writing test pieces for these bands for their competitions. And they were no less a name of Gustav Holst, Elgar, Vaughan Williams, all of them were writing for brass bands in the 20th century, early 20th century, before some of the great masterworks were written for orchestra. These men were writing for brass bands.
I found a little tidbit that I'm not sure if you can confirm or not. Could it be true that the formation of British brass bands was encouraged in the mines and factories as a way of maybe allowing the workers to think they were organizing without actually organizing?
That sounds like union talk to me. But it wasn't that way. I think it was for the pure pleasure of it, recreational approach. And an interesting thing that still exists to this day is all the brass players played in the treble clef. Those of you that are musicians know that mostly the upper instruments of an orchestra will play treble clef, lower instruments always in the bass clef. Piano players understand that. And the interesting thing was that they all were sharing instruments back in those early days, and they all